Good. So yes, this is our foundation of game design class. I'm Bernhard Riecke, and Morteza was a wonderful TA that was helping with this. And we're at Simon Fraser University in Vancouver and currently in Surrey, Canada, in Greater Vancouver region. All right, so one of the challenges we had obviously in this class, as in all of them, is like, how do we really adapt to a pandemic and not quite knowing whether we can fully teach in person or we have to switch to online teaching at any moment, basically. I'm getting rid of this somehow. Thanks. Oh, and you need to go back to click on the Zoom, on the PowerPoint, otherwise the remote doesn't work. Okay. So how do we teach through this? And I was really trying hard not to lecture for 2 hours, which in my opinion doesn't really work well, especially not online, but also not really in person. So one of the ideas was really for this class, for the students, was really to apply the idea of iterative design. Basically, like in all design, you want to get user experience, user feedback, and then apply it as often as iteratively as possible. And we tried to do this also for the classroom. So pretty much every week, there was hopefully some learning happening inside and outside the classroom. Through flipping the classroom, people had a chance to learn a lot on their own at home for all the kind of things that you really need a bit more time, or you might want to look things up. And then we connected this through what's called just-in-time teaching. So basically, students always had a purpose and activity, something to do with the assignments, how to apply. And the idea was basically that at home, people can start really working on the lower elements of Bloom's taxonomy, so really learning the basics. And then increasingly in class, we are hoping to apply this. So we wouldn't need to waste the precious time we have together here to just lecture things that people can better read at home. So how to make this work, especially how do we keep it flexible enough that we could potentially switch to online teaching if needed, because that was basically what nobody knew what was going to happen. So we used a lot of different online tools. Here's just a few of them. In particular, a tabletop simulator was quite useful. So this class is really about non-digital or board games, basically. And ironically, we switched to a board game simulator, which is basically a rapid prototyping engine that we started using during the pandemic. But it turned out to be so useful and save a lot of time that we actually keep using it, even if we do things in person. Well, the advantage of this is that at the end of this class, the games will be put online so others can play them as well, which helps a lot. The other challenge is, of course, well, if you have a group of students, sometimes the first few sessions there, a few we had to do online. How do we really make this work, and really how do I try to engage students in parallel? So we used Miro, an online whiteboard, quite a bit, asked people to think about, okay, why do we actually play, relate this to one of the game design frameworks, where the idea is really you have different kinds of fun that you can have, like the more hard fun of really competing, easy fun, which is more pastime, people fun, so anything related to social games, social media, but also what we often call transformative or purposeful fun. So basically games that stick around a bit longer in your mind, so some will have a positive effect that lasts beyond the actual gameplay itself. And then we ask people to reflect on a lot of different things, like where they would fit their game, where they locate themselves, basically. And in this class, for the final project, so there are basically 3 game design projects. For the last one, we asked people specifically to really think about designing from the inside out. So similar to this Pixar movie that you might have seen, we wanted people to really think about what is really the core, what is really the main idea of the user experience. So what is really a problem or a challenge that you could address through a game? So similar to normal design, actually addressing problems and trying to solve problems, we wanted to apply this to game design. So we asked people to think about the kind of themes and emotional experience that might actually work well with this and fit the overarching purpose of this class. And then basically you use and align all the different tools that we have in the game designer's toolbox, just a few of them, to really put this together. So we asked people also to reflect about what they really cared deeply enough about that it might actually be worth creating a game out of it and spending a lot of time on this. And also week or two later, we asked students to really reflect on, okay, their own experiences. Like, did you have any meaningful, purposeful experiences that you could draw on, that you can take inspiration to see how this really works? Use game design frameworks, really trying hard to start with the overall user experience, the aesthetics, and then seeing what kind of dynamics and mechanics of the game design would really help with that. And I'm proud to present six different student projects that they created in this semester. So applause just to start with. And so I'll go a bit more. I need to go to my website here in a moment. Can you access here? Too many different computers. Just want to briefly show the website. No, I don't want this right now. So this is where we try to put all the different information. So here's the current showcase that we're in. So basically what we'll do is for each team, we'll have about 12 minutes or so. We'll ask the student team, starting with team 1-1, to basically sit here. I'll also grab a seat here, and then we'll do a bit of an interview for about 10 minutes. And in the meantime, Morteza, if everything works out, he might share some live gameplay in the background. And else there. And as you see, we put all the information of the different games in there, including their title, razor, slogan, a bit more information here. Currently, there's a project trailer. We'll add more, including the recording of this session later on. And you can also get a glimpse of the websites, the project websites of the different teams. All right, I think that's it for now. No, we need to switch to the presentation. Do you have this ready? Okay, good. All right. So that's my first introduction. So if I could ask team 1-1 to just grab a seat here on these chairs, just come up here. We'll have a microphone here. So hopefully this will be able to capture everybody. And Morteza will be my time taker, will stop me if I go way too long. Okay. Just need to.
Yeah. I know only like you're gonna play with the team that I mentioned, like with the other team, and okay. These guys.
Stop we're screen sharing for a moment.
Right. So.
Just stop screen sharing for a moment. Yeah, stop screen share. Yes. Just give me a moment. If that wasn't set up yet, that should be in the showcases folder. Okay, we can start screen sharing again. There's the window. Yeah, just way too many things to do in parallel.
So again, team 1-1 versus team 1-4, team 1-2 versus team 1-2-1, and team 2-2 versus team 1-3. So you're going to play that first game, the same that you're interviewing people.
Okay, excellent. And I think you're outside of the camera. Just come over here, then you'll actually be seen. All right, so. And can you start playing the video?
I need the tabletop simulator, like the passport. Actually, I have to call.
Okay. In the meantime, let's play the video.
Play the video?
Yes, this one here. So, team 1-1 should be in the slides, the first slide. Not PowerPoint. This one anymore. Okay, so hopefully this will work with sound. So what? Do we have sound here? We do. Okay, let me double check this works on Zoom. Okay. So what I'd like to do is basically share the each student's team's project videos. It's basically a trailer of a minute. Let's just double check whether this works on Zoom. Explain what's going on there. All right, so this is team 1-1. Everything okay? Okay, team 1-1. Maybe just quickly introduce yourself with your name so we know who's who.
Okay, so my name is Gina, and I work with the team 1-1.
Okay, so tell us about the main idea of the game.
So Addiction Overcome or Succumb is like a team-based collaborative game where players will be...
Just going to move this a bit closer for two people and then turn it around. Okay, there you go.
Am I quirky?
Yeah.
It seems that the sound comes from your microphone.
So not both? Okay. Let's just switch this one around. Looks like only one of the microphones might be working. And just,
okay, you get to hold this one. Okay. All right, so what is your game about?
Okay, so Addiction Overcome or Succumb is like a team-based collaborative game where each player will play as different characters that take on the role of a person who's like struggling with addiction, and as they play throughout the game, they try to recover from their addiction and try to like basically recover within like a certain period of time.
Okay, let me just pass it on. So what motivated you? How did you come up with the idea of the game?
Drug abuse right now in DC is kind of at an all-time high. We're kind of noticing that those kind of the issues in kind of the downtown area. So we just kind of wanted to make a game kind of bringing attention to that, perhaps showing people who are suffering from it ways that they can be on the path to recovery, and also perhaps give a little bit of empathy toward people, because it is a very difficult thing to overcome and go back to normalcy.
And why is a game a good idea to, like, why would you want to use a game to give people that experience?
Doing a game allows you to put you in the shoes of a person, so it allows you more than like a movie or video or whatever. So it shows, makes you have to kind of take the steps to improving yourself, and also, you know, not just try to experience them through someone else's eyes. You have to be making decisions and doing stuff yourself.
Yeah. So.
Okay, so people will be like rolling a dice, and then after they choose like a path, there's different like path to walk, and then they draw like an event card, and that event card like shows like different options that they can take that affects the stats of the players, and then they can some of the cards will ask like will require like to ask for your team for like what they want. So you have to be aware of like everyone else's situation as well. Be some cards like benefit you or like benefit others people more. And then basically you try to gather enough stats to like recover all the way to 10.
Can you explain what's going on there right now?
Okay.
So basically.
Yeah, you can.
So basically, you start on the board, you have to move around it. You have to move certain spaces, and then you flip over one of the cards in the events tile. Then that will give you either something that happens to you immediately or some kind of task you'll have to do by either going around the board to complete a task or, you know, do some kind of objective during. So
basically by playing, you become a person, a personality, basically, but the pattern who has some kind of addiction challenge.
Yes. Yes.
So are there specific, no, let's actually go back to the core. Like, what would you like people to experience in the game?
So for the game, we like people to put themselves in the situation, because for their personal cards, like we stack the player, for example, if their recovery is really low, they will start at like the alleyway, which is like really bad. Like instead of like some, if someone is have a like high recovery, maybe they will start at like a Central Park, which is like more happier and situation place.
Yeah, and then are there specific main decision points, or like through how did you basically use game design to elicit the desired emotions in the game?
So in our game, we have event and different task card, which it requires player to cooperate with each other. And also in our character card, it will reveal the story of the character, and the player will get to understand more about the background information of the game and the drug addiction issue.
Morteza, do you have a few more minutes? We do in terms of timing. Yeah. Can you explain a bit what's going on in the background?
Okay.
I think you were sharing. Okay. If you can look there or in the back. So that's currently, people are actually playing it. Can you explain a bit what's going on there?
And like this part right here?
Yeah.
So right now, like as the you mean like picking up the cards, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so after the players like move across the board, the players will pick up like pick up a card from the deck, and on the deck it will describe like either like an event or a task that the players will probably need to like accomplish throughout the game, along with some flavor text that is happening simultaneously as like with the gameplay. So as they pick it up, they will, it might be just some flavor text, or like they will learn more about like the drug addiction and like the recovery as they read on the card.
Yeah. So you did user testing, right, with other playtesters. So what were experiences from players who actually played the game?
We found that players do, we were initially worried about it, but people do tend to look at the character and the bios and stuff like, and the events. So we kind of, people kind of make their own little story of what their character is going through. You know, it is also, it's a game where it's collaborative. So you're trying to work together. So people are trying to like strategize and work together. So that's been quite fun. Yeah. Also we have, we're talking about the events. A lot of the events give just a little bit of points. So you gradually will work towards a final goals, because drug abuse is a kind of gradual issue. You don't usually just pop it right into being recovered. So is a kind of satisfying, like gradual, slowly gaining enough points to win the game at the end.
Experience. Are there specific key moments or key decisions that you think contribute really to the main outcome of the game or the desired user experience?
Yeah. So a lot of the events require either a decision or a task you have to do, and sometimes you'll have to prioritize some tasks over others, and sometimes you will just be given a literal decision of, hey, choose decision A or decision B. A lot of those will give you kind of, some of them get more long-term impact, some of them get more short-term impact.
Okay, time's up? Okay. So Martez is playing the timekeeper. So thanks again. So applause. So so looking forward, Morteza, final words. You also played the game last week, right? What's your take?
Yeah, they have a really nice game, and
what was the
I need to
experience?
Yeah, I like that. Yeah, and I need to see the, I think they revised their games, right, from last week. So I need to check that version too. But yeah, I learned a lot.
All right, so thanks so much. You can grab a seat then. All right, so I'll briefly introduce the next team, team 1-2. You can already grab a seat here. Team 1-2, it's coming up here. And me.
User and password, like the server name and password for me, so I can join the table.
Just put it on Discord.
Yeah, put it on Discord, the workshop channel. Their game, right? You don't have it? They need to set up the game, or they need to send.
Just one second. Okay, we're just trying to solve some technical problems here in the background. So what we are hoping to do is play, have some students play the game live in the background on Tabletop Simulator, but it's always a challenge to set up everything in parallel. All right, team 1-2, come up here. And as soon as you're ready, and I'll start playing the project video. So what we have for team 1-2 is the project is called Veiled Memoir, Find Your Way, Find Yourself. Let me go ahead and play the project video here.
What about me? Who exactly am I?
Chronic diseases are the leading cause of death and disability worldwide, and Alzheimer's disease is one of the top 10 chronic diseases that can cause death. So what is it like to be an Alzheimer's patient? Introducing Veiled Memoir, a cooperative adventure board game that provides you with an opportunity to embark on a spiritual adventure in the mental world of an Alzheimer's patient. Players will take on the role of a basic physical or mental ability. Their main goal is to explore the mental world of an Alzheimer's patient named Rachel, to find her memory fragments to unlock four important forgotten memories. However, players will encounter various challenges representing Alzheimer's symptoms through event cards, hallucination cards, and disorientation cards. Will you be able to help Rachel retrieve her forgotten memories?
Right, it looks like the other microphone is not working, so let's just use this one. Alzheimer's is quite of a serious topic. Like, how did you come up with this project idea?
You can hold the microphone yourself. Because during our life, we look a TV show.
Just hold the mic a bit closer.
Oh, we look at we watch a TV show. It's called Don't Forget Me. And in this TV show, there are many Alzheimer people in this restaurant, and they need to do some.
So in that reality show, this Alzheimer's patient needs to do some services for the customers in the restaurant. And so we basically saw like they suffer a lot, and they, especially from memory loss, and sometimes they would experience hallucinations and even disorientation of space and time. So we think this reality show and also other films basically change our perspective on Alzheimer's. So we just think that maybe most of the people have also like the same wrong stereotype for this kind of disease. So we try to and tackle this problem in this game so that we want more people to understand like there are a lot more sufferings and hardships for those patients.
Yeah. And why do you think a game is a good idea to convey this as compared to like you mentioned a movie or a video or reading something?
Yeah, so basically a movie, they just presents all the visuals to you, but you don't necessarily participate in the story. But for games, you have like this experience. The rules are like setting a, you can say a magic circle that just allows you to use those rules and mechanics to really experience what these people will experience. So through games, they can even develop much deeper emotional experience that a movie cannot give. So this is why we use a game to tackle this problem.
So can you tell us a bit more? Are there like specific moments or specific actions in the game where you hope that these really trigger the key emotions that you want to elicit in the game?
Sure. So during our game, we designed some mechanics and some plots to transformative the experience of Alzheimer's. So basically, we have like all the ties are flipped down, and you can only see one ties that in front of you that representing like the Alzheimer's, even in their home. They can even remembering the spatial they have lived for years. And so it's like exploring a new place. And at the same time, we designed like event and hallucinations and disorder that represent the symptoms that they might be through. So we wish the player can also simulating like their feeling when they go through these symptoms.
Okay, interesting. We only have one mic, so we're just going to pass back and forth. Hope that's okay. Very interesting. So I'm going to ask you about the actual playtest experience. So you did user testing basically, and did you observe some of the things you intended? What did you do observe? What did you not observe? And how did that change your game?
During our self-test, like the first vision of our game, we find that the challenge, the game is too challenging. Like, so we experience the struggle of the Alzheimer patient, but like the game is too challenging. Like we cannot even finish the game, and we think we should balance the fun and the challenge of the game to like encourage player to at least complete the game so that they will gain the whole transformative experience. So we increase more event cards and player cards to help them finish the game, and like balancing the whole challenge and with a more interesting plot, I guess. So like during the next playtest, we found it's more balancing through the fun and challenging thing.
Yeah. I mean, especially for a topic like Alzheimer, there's a lot of research and written about it. So what did you find in your research about Alzheimer's, and what the key issues are that you hope to put into this game?
Based on our research, we found there are some situations that Alzheimer will be faced, such as they will disorientation and they will hallucination, and sometimes they will lose some memory. In order to create our game, like we use the unknown tales to instead of the Alzheimer to lose their memory. So also this process simulated the Alzheimer's memory, and we also created some different cards to simulate this situation, such as the event cards, hallucination cards, and player cards. In these cards, our game have some different story and different situation in these cards. And finally, in the game, we have a different memory treasures. And if the player open this treasure, and they will get the memory card and know this story.
Mortezo, how are we doing in terms of time? 3 minutes? I realize I completely forgot to ask you to introduce yourselves. So,
hi, my name is Amy. I'm Joe.
I'm Meng.
I'm Hannah.
So, is this live gameplay that we're seeing in the background? All right. So can you tell us a bit more what's going on there right now in the game, what people are doing?
You can also look over there. Okay. I think it's...
Yeah, you can.
it's better here. So basically this player is moving around in the space, and the main goal is to just try to find resources. Those resources represent memory fragments. And so this player, he just moves on to another one, and then like,
wait a minute. Start in the center, or where do they start?
Yeah, they start in the center, but like they have to flip up the tile. Yeah. Wait.
I'm just the observer.
I think they need to flip the tile, and then also for one, like for.
Okay, it looks like people are messing up the game boards right now. Okay.
Morteza, you also played the game last week, right? Can you tell us a bit more?
What was your user experience inside the camera view?
Okay. Yeah. They have a collaborative game, like a bit different. So you need to discover things when you move from the center. You learn things about the Alzheimer and like the issues related to that. And like when you find special treasures along the way, you'll find different parts of the memories, and that way, like that creates the story of the game. And at the end, like you have like a completed story that talks about like a person that had different kind of Alzheimer's issues. Yeah.
How was your user experience? Like, did you feel a bit like you got a glimpse of the?
Yeah. Experience? Yeah. Yeah, that was like, I couldn't like experience the whole story because we had a like limited time, but yeah, it was interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. So thanks so much.
And applause.
All right. Thanks. And yeah, looking forward to seeing more. And as you know, in about a week or so, there will also be project videos which provide more information about everything. All right. So. Do you want to announce anything, Martez?
Yes. Yeah.
No, you don't need to.
So, guys, team 1-3, you need to come here. But before coming here, please start your server and share the username and password on this one. Yeah. Okay, got it. Yeah, got it. So, 1-3 feedback, guys from team 2-2, you need to play there again, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, perfect. Then come up here. And can you play their project video in the background? Right. So next up, we have team 1-3. So we're just basically numbering the teams here to keep it simple. All right, so yeah, grab a seat. There's some, yeah, okay, I think we have enough chairs, perfect. All right, so this is team Re-Educate.
Maybe just introduce yourself, basically, your name and what are the key things you did in the game.
So my name is Annette, and I did most of the game piece designs.
Hi, I'm Laura. I also helped with the game piece designs, making up like the rule sheet design, made the poster.
Hi, I'm Rohan, and I helped with making the game board and kind of the aesthetic of the game.
I'm Harry, and I helped with the brainstorming, and I made the trailer video.
My name's Gary. I help with creating the website and also coming up with the concept as well.
Yeah, so there's lots of different tasks. So let's go ahead and start by looking at the project video.
It's basically saying your homosexuality is an attempt to repair something other than your sexuality. You're using your homosexuality as an attempt to repair certain deficits within yourself, whether it be gender identity or key identity issues within yourself.
Re-Education is a turn-based game where players are each given an emotion that they will play inside the mind of an individual who's going through conversion therapy. Players must work together to save the mind and memories from being brainwashed or risk losing the individual's sense of self. The mind is made up of tiles that, as the game progresses, will slowly be lost to being brainwashed. And as the tiles are lost, so are precious memories. So it's everybody's job to work together and save this person.
All right. So again, quite a heavy topic. Like, how did you come up with the idea?
Yeah, so that was funnily enough.
Therapy is basically.
Right as we were being the time where we started this project at my workplace, funnily enough, one of our clients got in a little bit of trouble because they were talking online about not voting for the bill that would ban conversion therapy for minors. And that kind of just got me thinking a little bit about it when we were talking about bigger issues. And as somebody who is part of the LGBT community, this was something that I felt very close to, because for me, it's something where it's, you know, I'm lucky with the family that I have, but there are a lot of people in BC, especially who aren't as lucky and who might get sent to these practices. And it was something that I think that there should be more information about, because I think a lot of people kind of forget that these practices are still used and especially how harmful they can be.
So what do you hope to achieve through this game?
I think it was mostly our focus was kind of education. I think reminding people that these practices do exist, and especially the harm that they do. In the research that Annette and I did, you know, we found that individuals who come from a family where their parents are unaccepting of their sexuality and they're also pushed into these types of therapy are 3 times as likely to attempt suicide. Their depression rates are also 3 times higher. And so just kind of educating people that this does still exist. It is still an issue. It isn't, you know, it hasn't gone away. And yeah, making people aware that there are bills that, you know, we would like people to vote for and pass.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, when I first heard that in Canada this is still happening, I just couldn't believe it. I was really shocked. Actually, also quite grateful that you dare to take this on. So what kind of user experience do you want people to have in there? Like, do they take on the person who has to get or got conversion therapy? Or what, like, tell us a bit more.
So our initial concept was that we would have people take on the role of one person inside these camps, but we decided against that. And basically, the players take on the role of something inside the mind of one of the people at these conversion therapy camps. And they're trying to make sure that the memories of that person don't fade away. So the game board itself is being played inside the mind of one of these people. And they're trying to make sure that person doesn't get brainwashed.
So it's each player a different person then, or do they all play the same person and the same mind?
They're playing inside the mind of the same person. And as they, on each turn, they pull an event card. And that corresponds to something that happens to the real life person's environment. And they can see how it affects them and how they can.
Okay, interesting. Can you tell us a bit more, like, okay, why a game? And so how did you use the ideas of game design, magic circle, and so on to create something that addresses the larger issue?
So in the research that Annette and Laura did, the other kind of stuff that talks about conversion therapy are all kind of movies, TV shows, documentary. And in those ones, you kind of get a sense of what it's like through the lens of another person. But in the game, you get to play as like inside the person, you get to experience what they go through and how it affects them. So we're hoping that through this game, you gain a sense of kind of empathy for people who actually go through these kind of experiences.
Yeah, so basically really using the interactivity, you actually stepping into a specific role, you playing somebody in a safe environment without having to go to actual conversion therapy. So you play tested a couple of different times. Like, what did you find in there? What did you observe? How did that change the way you designed or improved your game?
Yeah, so initially our initial concept was kind of being inside of a camp and then trying to escape that camp. But through our playtesting, we quickly found out that it wasn't really addressing the transformative aspect or like any of the other fun aspects that we designed for. So it was kind of more like a survival game. So we kind of redefined our whole concept and we imagined it inside the mind of somebody who would be going through the activities in the camp. And then that kind of, through our more playtesting, we kind of found out that addressed the transformative aspect a lot better.
Yeah.
So can you tell us a bit more what's currently going on in the background and or also like how does playing the game actually work? You don't need to go through all the rules, okay. Just kind of the main idea.
Okay, so as you can see, this is our new, this is a bit different from our game trailer, but this is our revised map of this person's mind, arranged through these tiles. And basically, our players here are moving through the mind and taking actions. And what they need to do is to collaborate with each other to collect a certain a combination of keys to unlock memories of the person that are related to the person's identity. And those keys are indicated on the memory chests over there. So you can see you need two silver keys to unlock that memory chest. And behind those cards are the memories that you can read at the end of the game. Yeah.
Great. Yeah, it's fascinating. So if you had another few weeks to work on the game, what would you do? Like, where would you take it?
Yeah, so I think when Morteza playtested for us, we got a really a lot of really good ideas from him as well. And I know in our previous iteration, when we're focusing on escaping a camp, we had this idea of having like a security guard that would patrol the tiles. And then if you got caught, you'd be like taken back to camp. And he mentioned possibly implementing something like that back in, which we didn't have time to do this week. But if we had more time, I would love to explore that more and have a sort of boss-like character to kind of help bring in a bit more of like the bonding with the players of having to defeat something and then having that tie into, you know, maybe like the negative like or internalized homophobia, something like that that you have in your brain that is something negative that you have to overcome, and then using that as something that the players then have to bond together to kind of defeat. I think that would have been a lot of fun if we had more time, but
yeah there's never enough time. Talking about time, Morteza, how are we doing in terms of timing?
3 minutes
left. Oh, excellent. Good. Then, do we have any audience questions? I think they're all busy playing more. So my next question is a bit about specific moments in the game. Like, and one of the things that's specific about games, you can, it's interactive, so there might be dilemmas, there might be conflicts. How did you, or did you create any meaningful conflicts, interesting dilemmas, and so on? And if so, how do they work, and what did you find?
Well, I guess one interesting mechanic, as you know, you to complete the game, you have to open up all the memory chests. So, and you need keys to do that. So an interesting dynamic we included was that if a person has keys and they're standing on the same tile as another player, they're allowed to give the keys to the other player. So that would promote having to like collaborate in order to open the memory chests. I think that was really interesting.
Just trying to... So there's a, on the left side, there's a sanity score. Can you explain what that one's doing and how it's affected by the gameplay?
Yeah, so the sanity meter is kind of like a health bar. So when you pull event cards, you have, there's a couple sanity drop cards in there. So so when you pull one, your sanity drops down one. And then when you reach zero, basically all the players lose, and that's when you lose the game. And there are some chances to raise the sanity also. So it's kind of helped regulate the game so that you don't always win. Yeah.
And so who's your intended audience for the game? I mean, it's, I assume it's not or maybe especially not people who went through LGBTQ conversion therapy, but who basically who's the audience and who should you be playtesting with if you had more time?
Yeah, I think this game is pretty open to anybody that wants to learn more about conversion therapy camps and like the effects it has on individuals that attend these camps, but also LGBTQ individuals as well and their families, their parents that want to know what goes on these camps, and just, yeah, it's pretty open to anyone really.
Yes. Time's up. Okay. All right. Well, thanks so much about this. I really hope you get a chance to continue working on this exciting game. And yes, it hopefully will be online on Tabletop Simulator in a week or two, because I think it's, as the other ones, it's, I think it's a really important project. So thanks and applause again. Okay. Somehow we should try and get the sound up a bit here. Right. You need to make an announcement?
Yeah.
Okay, so quick announcement from Orteza, technical things.
Now we have team 1-4. So team 1-1 needs to playtest their game, and team 1-4, before coming here, please again share your server name and password on Discord and then pop it in. I can't hear you. Yeah, put it in one for feedback channel.
Yeah.
Yeah, guys, put it in your team name feedback channel.
Okay. And if one pure person still needs to do something, do that. The rest can already come up here, basically. All right. So next up we have team 1-4. Morteza's just getting up the slides. You still screen share? Okay. All right. Actually, maybe move over there then, because I'll need to constantly go back and forth. Not numbers. Just easier. And yeah, there should be enough chairs, I hope. All right. The next one. All right. So this is team 1-4. And let's do quick introductions. Just your name and what are the kind of key things you did for the game?
Okay, I'm Zev. I did the diagrams for the games and I work mostly on like the rule sheet and inspiration and copywriting.
Hi, my name is Ricky and I work mainly on the game mechanics and the balancing of the game.
Hello, my name is Crystal. I mostly worked on the actual tabletop board and I helped with inserting on the official game website and such.
My name is Shirley, and I mostly worked on all of the art in the game.
My name is Lewis, and I mainly work on the mechanics and fixing up the website as well.
Hi, my name is Eugene. I mainly worked on some of the event cards. I helped with brainstorming and the game trailer.
Yeah, well, thanks a lot. So as you see, there's lots of different jobs in game design. So it's great to have a good team. All right, Morteza, can you start the project trailer?
Wake of the UN Climate Change Conference, fossil fuel companies are seeking to sue governments for potentially trillions in lost revenue, which could threaten newly made environmental commitments. Climatic Crisis is a cooperative strategy game in which players take on the roles of corporations who are seeking to expand their profits. Players must compete to be the top earning company while preventing the annihilation of the environment due to their common enemy, the fossil fuel industry. Players may buy and sell land or purify the environment, all while choosing between dilemmas given to them via event cards. Will you be able to come out on top without causing irreversible harm to the environment? Play and find out. Manage your worth, together go forth, save the earth.
Quite a current topic, still want to see how you came up with the topic and was that the main idea that your team pursued and how did that work?
Well, when we were like doing the first activity in the workshop where we were just going over like common interests, our team had like a common interest of climate change, but obviously it's a very broad topic. So we wanted to narrow it down. And then with the very recent United Nations, they had an environmental conference. They made some laws that they wanted to like put in for environmental protection, but like a lot of corporations are now trying to sue the governments. In order to protect their profits. So we wanted to focus on how corporations can impact the environment very heavily and how they ignore environmental issues just, you know, to gain as much money as they can.
And actually, maybe you can continue just in the middle of it. So why using a game for this?
Because then we can put the players in the roles of these corporations and show them exactly how these corporations have responsibility and the direct impact they do. And just showing them that like sometimes it's not just based on like everyday people, because everyday people, we try our best. We use paper straws and paper bags, but our impact at the end of the day is very minuscule compared to these companies.
Yeah. So you really get to play the company in that game. So tell us a bit more how the game works and how you try to address climate crisis.
Yeah. So how the game works, the core mechanic is essentially dilemmas that the players choose between. Most of the dilemmas will be either helping the environment, but at a cost. And some of them would be monetary gain at the cost of the environment. So players will have to make decisions every round and kind of balance their own money and also how much they want to affect the environment.
So basically each person plays a different company, or how does it work? So do the individual players play against each other, against the system?
Yeah, so every player acts as their own, but they face off against a common enemy. So the common enemy is the black tiles in the middle. And we kind of made it in a way that every few rounds, the black tiles will spread. And all the players are working together to purify all the black tiles. And if they purify all the black tiles, they win the game. However, there's also some player versus player conflicts in the game. So at the end of the game, your money is totaled up, and the player with the most money wins the game. However, there are some aspects of it that is not just monetary value. So for example, we try to add aspects like, if you purified the most land, you might get a special bonus. Or if you do more acts for the environment, you might also get bonuses that will help you win the game.
Maybe tell me a bit more what's going on in the background. I think people are starting to play.
Oh, so like the general gameplay? Oh, for our general gameplay is that at the very beginning of our game, each player gets $300. And on the very first turn, they don't get passive income. So our gameplay is separated into three phases. Our first phase is the passive income phase, where each player gets $200 upon their round. The second phase is the buy, sell, purify phase. These tiles that you can see, the green tiles, they can essentially be bought by the player. The colored tiles. So like they act as like when you buy them, it's like the company buying them. The black tiles is an abstract representation of climate change. And
it's kind of like the planetary boundary.
Yeah.
If you cross that, then basically the whole thing collapses.
I guess, but but yeah, for the buy sell purify phase, the players can buy, they can sell their color tiles, or they can, if one of their color tiles is touching the black tile, they can purify it. So the player can do that, and then in order to end their round, they can either pay $500 to gain a green token, which is like I guess a medal or a representation that you're helping the environment. Or they can gain $500 to earn a red token, which is like bad reputation because you're gaining money at the cost of the environment. Or if they don't choose to take either tokens, they can get a bank card. And the bank card, when you flip over, has two dilemmas. And the dilemmas can be positive, positive. They can be negative, negative, or they can be positive, negative, depending on. So we try to make an aspect of dilemma in there.
Thanks. Yeah, it's sometimes hard to breathe with all the masks on. Can you tell us a bit more about the dilemmas? It sounds really interesting to have positive, negative. So can you give us some examples how these work?
So the idea of dilemmas, we put them as our core mechanic of our gameplay. So you would find most of the dilemmas and these kind of decision types within our cards. For example, if Morteza can hover over one of the event cards. Oh, that's a boss card. the green. Yeah, so like there would be two different, based on like the card, there's like a short narrative that sort of provides some information for you about the climate, about our topic. And then that narrative also ties in with like the two decisions that a player can make. And we try to incorporate as many different types of dilemmas as possible. So there are aspects in some cards where you can have one really like good a choice or one really bad choice, where it could be positive, positive, negative, negative. We just try to ensure that there's like many different variations of like a dilemma choice.
Thanks. It's fascinating. So with all these dilemmas and so on, what are some key emotions or experiences that you hope players have that they couldn't have in just whatever, watching a video or attending COP26 or looking at the devastating news?
Yeah, so it's just to make it more understandable and relevant to the player. So like sometimes when a dilemma is like, I don't know, everybody gets like $100 and like you sacrifice like a couple of trees, or everybody gains like $200, but except for you, you only get like 50. It's like, it doesn't really matter for the most part, especially when you see like companies on like the news and whatnot being like, oh, they traded like these stocks for like this land. It's like, it doesn't mean anything to you, right? But then in this game, under this format, it's like, okay, well, do I want to prosper, or do I want like everybody else to prosper? Or is that like, if we all prosper, is that like, would the black tiles, or in this case, like pollution, corruption, stuff like that, would we be damaging the environment too much to the point where we can't actually win anymore despite how rich we are, right? So it's like these types of more detailed thoughts that we're trying to bring up in the players to get them thinking more.
What are the emotions that you hope to trigger in there?
We basically want them to feel pretty confident early on, kind of like how these companies, they kind of just like do what they want, right? But then there's going to come a time when you can't just do whatever you want, because like the black tiles are spreading, you can't just go, like you don't have the resources to just go do whatever. And then it's kind of like greed that turns into like guilt or like panic or whatever else. And then that's when like the real critical thinking starts happening.
Another thing to add on to that, so we do have a part of the game where if a climate crisis happens, the black tiles will start spreading. And based on like playtesting and a bunch of our like own observations and other observations, we noticed that like most players felt like a sense of like realization or shock, like whoa, like when the tiles started spreading, giving them like a visual sense of like climate change is something that can just like change everything in an instant. Yeah.
So basically they get to experience something that is not as easily experiential currently, unless you live in BC in the lower mainland. I get completely flooded right now. So you did this project basically in anticipation of the current local crisis even. So you did a lot of playtesting, right? So what did you observe in there? You hinted already a bit to this. So what were some of the user feedback, and how did you use these to evolve the game?
Well, one of the things during our initial playtest we found was that there wasn't enough emotion evoked in the player when they played, because they didn't really feel like they were playing a game, or they were playing as like a big company. They were just like the cards and stuff, they just had like events and stuff. They didn't really have descriptions about what's happening. So it didn't really have a like really big impact on like them as a person and like how it transformed them. So to fix this, we found that like adding descriptions of on the event cards about what's going on and like how their actions are affecting the climate, we found that like it had a much bigger emotion on the player, and we use this to fix our game like that.
Time's up. Okay, one last question. Like, if you had another, let's say, a few weeks to further improve the game, what would you do?
We would probably implement some features that we were thinking about implementing, but we just didn't have the time to. Like, we were thinking about adding purification tokens for whenever you would purify the environment, you would get one. So it's kind of like a reward and a more incentive for the players to purify, in addition to just, you know, saving the planet. And also we were thinking about like adding a counter so players could just automatically track their money, and then they wouldn't have to like count it all up at the end.
One final thing. Well, I guess it's more of a not an idea to add, but when we were playtesting, a lot of our issues came from like our balancing, because we tried to like our money amount at first, we thought it was too less, but then when we increased it, it was too much. And then like some of the event cards, we had to skew around. So like a lot of our problems during our playtesting came from like the balancing issues. So if we had a few more weeks, we would probably playtest more to find what would be a right amount.
Yeah, good point. Yeah, tweaking and balancing game system is really hard, and but it's also so essential to make it all work. All right, thanks again. So I hope a lot of people get a chance to play this game. All right, thanks. You can grab a seat. Access team 2-1, right? Yeah, so team 2-1.
And again,
once you set it up,
okay,
should be all there.
Yeah. And team 1-2, we need to play your game. Okay.
Okay. All right, so grab a seat. Maybe do quick introductions and then play the video. All right, so here's team 2-1, don't carry the weight. So let's do quick introductions. So who you are, what your name is, and what your key role was in the game design project.
Hi, I'm Soren, and I was the kind of the task manager of the group, just kind of like the organizer, setting up schedules and did some of the cards.
So my name is Herman, and for this project I was mainly the gameplay designer, just kind of in designing the overall the overarching systems was a large part of my role.
My name is Elias, and I was the game designer, and I also set up the prototype and developed like the cards and everything for this game.
Hi, I'm Emmanuel. I was the main illustrator and just editing the videos or helping with the design of the poster.
Thanks. All right, so let's take a look at your project video. So that's
as a result of the rising mental health epidemic within our demographic, we created Don't Carry the Weight, a cooperative board game centered around social support. Players take control of characters of varying backgrounds, encountering everyday stresses and anxieties while learning to cope with them. The core gameplay of Don't Carry the Weight consists of characters encountering life events, large and small, along the way, with the main objective being to struggle against the game's system and reach the end as a collective. Elements of the game are designed to mirror the complexities of mental health. We represent progress through tiles players walk through, allowing them to visualize the otherwise unseen steps that their characters are making. With a clear start and end to serve as primary objectives, players are met with a hidden, randomized, maze-like board that they have to navigate through, representing their journey through their struggles. All in all, we want to bring people together to share their experiences, and we want you to be a part of that. Grab up to 6 players and experience Don't Carry the Weight together, ages 13 and up.
How did you come up with the game idea? It sounds a bit like struggling as a student at SEAT.
I mean, it's part of it, but the concept is like stress is just such a common thing. We all deal with it. It's something everyone can understand it. So we just wanted to find a game that focuses on that aspect and figures like how stress can be easily built up if not managed correctly, as well as incentivize people to manage that stress, not individually, but helping others as well.
So it's cooperative?
Yeah, it's a cooperative,
so-
yeah.
Everybody plays against the system?
Yeah, everyone is playing against the system, exactly.
Okay. All right, so why did you use a game for this? Like, why not just whatever, create a blog or yet another video book about stress and coping with stress?
I think stress and anxiety as a whole is like something we all feel commonly, but we don't really like recognize it because there's varying degrees of stress and anxiety people feel, right? And so we thought like a game would give us a good opportunity to actually visualize stress and anxiety for people on the board and through game mechanics that we designed, where like players would encounter bad events and they would have their stress go up and their health go down. Or if they encounter good events, they would have their stress relieved. And there were also actions they could take, like, for example, they could rest in a turn, and then, you know, they would relieve some of their stress and regain some of their health. So it's stuff like that, just basic life stuff, like events, and to kind of like show how stress and anxiety, it's all like a shared experience. It's all, you know, connected to each other.
So you're basically simulating real life stress situations.
Yeah.
Everybody has that in real life. So why a game? Like, what do you do differently in a game?
I think like the different experience over here was like the fact that the game is designed in a way that it challenges you, because like in this game, it's very hard for you to reach the end by yourself. So it automatically becomes like a collaborative experience where you want to help each other to get to the end together. So we wanted to collectivize that. We wanted people to realize that this, like life itself, right? Like stress, anxiety, everything, this should be shared. Like we need to help each other. And that was our main goal, where we recognize that like mental health is a problem that develops from stress, anxiety. And so we wanted to, you know, make people understand that there are similar things that other people feel, but it might affect them differently. It might affect them more. So that's visualized on like the board itself. Like some people get like worse cards, worse bad events, and they get more stress and more health decrease. And so, you know, it kind of like simulates like you got to help each other to reach the end. Mm-hmm.
So Herman, can you tell us a bit more what's currently going on and how the game works?
Okay, so essentially what's going on right now, I believe they're in the process of moving. So there's a round counter all the way at the top, and that's kind of a time limit for how long the players have to reach the end. And as you can see, they're moving along kind of a randomized like map of sorts that gets gradually revealed as they move along, kind of simulating how you can't really foresee what happens and like what you're going to encounter.
Just like real life.
Exactly, just like real life. And their movement is also kind of largely determined by stress. We intentionally balanced everything around 2d6, knowing that statistically it uses a bell curve distribution. So the higher your stress is, because that's directly subtracted from your dice roll, the higher stress is, the harder it gets for you to kind of move forward.
So just like in real life, the more exactly. stressed you are, the harder it is to cope with everything, the more stressed you get, and then you have a vicious cycle.
Exactly.
Okay. And are people able to break through that in the game? Or what? Okay, so you simulate the real-time vicious cycle of being stressed, and then use time pressure to stress people even more.
Exactly.
And then what?
And then just over the... Just through the course of it, it's more the little subtle things that kind of make people work together. We've also designed a quest system, a kind of optional sub goal that players can pursue. That's more of a collaborative effort where everyone gets rewarded. In addition, when you look at the dominant strategies of the game, those all kind of, because there's no like first place winner, as long as you get to the end, you're a winner. So kind of the more dominant strategies revolve around making sure everyone can push forward and reveal as much as they can. So in those subtle ways, we're trying to push this collaborative, cooperative aspect to kind of tackling these sort of, like tackling stress and anxiety in real life as well.
Interesting. So how did you design for these specific moments and experiences where people realized, oh, they need to work together? So basically, are there specific moments, elements, aha moments? How did you design for this? Did they actually happen and all of that?
Yeah, so the collaborative moments, each player gets a choice of actions. So they could either revive a person, or they could also take an action point to trade a card per person. So that's the collaborative portion of each player. And also some of our card events will also add less stressors to the player. And Also, in the beginning of the game, players are prompted with a quest, which they all each have to. It's optional quest, but it will like largely assist them with the overall gameplay. But if they succeed in this quest, it will give them a huge advantage in progressing through the game. So these objectives, they kind of play along in real life, like say, oh, there's a real life COVID pandemic happening, and players are required to stay away from each other for a set amount of turns. And if they do succeed, they get less stress into their player health. And yeah.
So that's how we try to simulate
real life.
Yeah, and the working together aspect of the game.
Yeah.
The people fun.
Yeah. Yeah, so I was just going to ask, what's the people fun aspect? So basically, is there cooperative fun as well? So it's not just hard and stressful?
Yeah, I mean, the idea is there's part of easy fun is not just a little part of easy fun is not very, they don't need like think a lot about what they're going to do. Although they might be like a few actions they have to take. It's not that of like to call it a hard one or anything like that. It's actually very... It's kind of easy to understand it. It's also like mainly our main goal was to make it cooperative. It's like the main objective of all.
So basically, you hope that people have these kind of realizations, these moments where they kind of get it, and then afterwards, hopefully, are also more cooperative. Is that right? So, do you have any evidence from playtesting or from any of the testing that this happened? Who wants to answer this?
We did have evidence where we actually asked players like how they felt and everything, and they were like, yeah, we understood that, you know, this was like emulating stress and anxiety, like, you know, that they were getting frustrated. It's like difficult situations. And then there were situations where like a teammate had fallen behind and all the other team members that were ahead were trying to actively help that player get forward. So it became a collaborative experience that way. And also like we had to make changes and everything. So one of the bigger changes, like to force like collaboration as well, we did was like if a teammate before we had a revive function, like you could revive teammates that have fallen below health, but instead we said like we make it so that if a player falls to zero health or below, then they become eliminated. And also what happens is the surviving members, they get like immediate -5 health. So that becomes a mechanic where you have to like try and work to try and help each other or collaborative. And also like kind of like shows like when you lose someone in your life, it's also like, you know, it affects everyone deeply.
So did this have an effect on your actual team collaboration? Because it's pretty much like real life. Everybody's stressed and you can either do your own thing and try to get you on.
Yeah, I mean,
sorry, I just wanted to add to that thanks to the like the thing we did with the board is that every single gameplay kind of opens a new kind of response of the people, because the board always transforms into different aspects. You may start like very unlucky and have a lot of bad events, or you may start like a lot of luck and then slowly gather even more bad events, even going closer to what like closer to like normal life. Basically, you never know how it's going to happen, and every time you play could change differently.
Yeah. So did it affect the way you as a team collaborated? I mean, sure, you play tested it quite
a bit. Yeah, when we played, yeah, it changed a lot every time. Sometimes we were just lucky, and let's say we just run out to the end with any troubles. In other cases, myself, I was stuck at the beginning for the whole game. I couldn't even move to all the bad stress there was.
Okay.
How are we doing in terms of timing, Morteza? One more minute. Okay, so if you had a little bit more time, where would you take this game, basically?
If we had more time, I would actually love to focus more on the narrative and written aspects of the game, just to give players more time to absorb more information than what we had time to write on these events, quests, and like the character biographies as well. Maybe if we had more time to research and really dive deep into some of the more psychological aspects to stress and anxiety, then that would create a more like a richer experience for the players.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Great. And I think, okay, should probably move on to the next one. So thanks again. And yeah, I hope a lot of people get to play this game. So to enhance the realization that really it's only through collaboration that you can make it through life and through the social network. So thanks again. All right. So I think we have one more game to go. Is that correct? So last but not least, you're six people. So just grab all the chairs that are in the back there. Montez is setting things up. The chairs in the back there. All right, yes, you can wave at the camera. All right, so I'd like to, oh yeah, you need to squeeze in a bit, this collaborative. So let's do quick introductions, who you are and what your main roles were in the game.
I'm Bruce, I'm playtester. I particularly like the game mechanics as well as sort of keep the group organized. I think I was more secondary in that role.
I'm Michelle, and my main role is making the graphic for the board and as well as the card.
I'm Evelyn. I'm also like mainly focused on the boards, designing the boards and the cards.
Hi, I'm Matthew. I wrote the rules as well as the I made the trailer you're going to see in a moment here.
Yeah. I'm Kelly. I basically managed the project and did a bit of everything.
All right, good. Are we ready to play the trailer? There you go.
Once I heard someone got rich, I NFT. But what is an NFT? Standing for non-fungible token, an NFT is a digital asset from which a receipt can be bought, held onto, and sold for higher profit, like stocks. Anything can be an NFT. Images, videos, games, even your favorite McDonald's burger can be sold for riches beyond your imagination. Sounds like a good deal, right? Well, why don't you find out? Once I Heard Someone Got Rich by NFT is a board game in which you take the role of an aspiring NFT investor. You'll watch as the prices of NFTs fluctuate and try to make a quick profit. How you play is up to you. Buy low, sell high, buy an illegal NFT, have it confiscated, pay expenses, go into debt. But be careful, for every NFT transaction you do will slowly but surely consume energy and lead to disaster. How you play is up to you, but you wouldn't buy the receipt to a JPEG and sell it to others for insane amounts of money at the cost of the planet, would you?
All right, so who has actually ever purchased an NFT here in this room? Anybody?
No.
You did? Okay, one person did. All right. Bruce, you did? Okay, so how did you come up with the idea, and what do you think is the real issue behind NFTs? It's a lot in the media.
So like, I personally know people who got into NFTs as well as people who are like super against it, but yeah, so I proposed this idea because I'm on Twitter and I see like a lot of people like who don't know what NFTs are. Like I see like a post every day where someone's like asking what are actually NFTs and like why are they bad.
Maybe you can explain briefly to people what an NFT actually is.
Yeah, so NFT is a non-fungible token, meaning like is like something. How do I? So non-fungible means like you can't exchange it for like anything like currency or something. So it has like fluctuating value, and an NFT can be basically anything. So you can take it. It's basically something that says you own something in a database, and that's something. Yeah, yeah. So that something can be anything, like an image, video, GIF, music, and stuff like that. And so basically, you're buying the owner's a key to the database that says you own that thing that you bought. Yeah.
Yeah, if you would
So if you would have tried to explain this to somebody 30 years ago, it would have seemed fairly absurd, basically. So what are the issues? Like, why did you choose NFTs? Like, what's the problem with it? I mean, it just seems like gambling, basically.
Well, so what we found is stuff from Kelly's experience about people having their art taken and used as NFTs just like without their consent. And like the big one we highlighted here is just environmental impact, because so how a blockchain works is every time you buy or sell an NFT, and the more just every transaction you make, it basically the blockchain is a really long receipt and it just keeps adding on to that. So the longer it gets, the more power you need to consume. And I think we found like the current like amount of energy needed to buy an NFT was like what, like 120 times that of a household microwave or something like that. It was just a stupidly big amount. So we figured, okay, I didn't know that until I did the research, and I did some research into legal stuff, and we didn't know that either. So if we didn't know this until we researched it, like what are people in the public doing? So we figured we could bring this in a game format to kind of highlight, you know, if you want to get into NFTs, fine, but just know that these are some of the dangers that can come along with it.
So why a game? Like, why not another blog post or podcast about NFTs?
Well, I think we figured that just NFTs, they're stupidly complicated. And this game is kind of, it's a very small scale simulation of the market. And rather than reading just a very long article or a blog post or whatever, we thought it would be better for there to be an actual game experience, something hands-on, so players can feel for themselves what it's like to make, or at least on a smaller scale, what it's like to make a big profit or lose something or have something illegal confiscated and so forth.
So people literally have the experience of trading an NFT, but with the risk constrained to the actual game.
Yes.
Great. So what are key moments in the game? Like what kind of, well, there's two parts. So what is the desired user experience? So how do you really use emotions triggered in the games to go to address the overall issue behind this?
In my opinion, the key moment would be when the players actually reads the events cards and also reads like the disaster cards, when they realize like how risky it is when they investing in NFT. And also at the end game, they would realize when they read the win condition, they will realize that only the cash they are holding is counting for the win. Like if they earn more cash, they will win, but not the NFT they're holding. The NFT they're holding is not count for like any adds to any winning to the game. Yeah.
So it's a bit more about the conflicts and how that triggers emotions in there. Like I think you mentioned some dilemmas in the game. Like how did you use those?
For dilemmas in the game, because like every time when a transaction is made, the blockchain is like the transaction is added to the blockchain counter, and every time when it goes up, it will also affect the power breaker. And since like the power breaker, like when it reaches 100, it will trigger the disaster event. So like one of the dilemma that like we need to consider as players is when it's almost reaching to 100, they will need to think either they want to get the NFT for a lower value or trigger the power breaker. And triggering the power breaker will like also make the game end faster, as well as like other negative effects to every player in this game.
So I wonder what the user experience is like. So what did you observe in the playtesting rounds that you did from people actually going through this, and how did it affect how you redesigned your game?
I think, our concept of like, you know, like NFTs being very risky and whatnot did get across very well. Unfortunately, it leaned into the game being too having too much transformative fun and not enough of, you know, people fun, easy fun and hard fun. So it sort of just became a, I would say, a model rather than a game. So we had to figure out a way to try to balance that. The player that in last, like, how do we help them out so that, you know, they still feel like they're participating in the game, right? Still feel like maybe not a chance at winning, right? But like placing higher than last. And that was something we really decided to focus on because the aspects of like ridiculousness did seem to get across with the images that we chose to represent with NFTs, right? So I think that part was very successful and we wanted to focus more on the gameplay.
I think you mentioned you're the designated playtester. So how did playing this game affect your likelihood of actually trading with NFTs or your response if some of your friends or other people, you hear them trading with NFTs?
I think this game really demonstrate like a very simple demonstrate how NFTs market works. Because especially in our game, the NFT value will change turn by turn, just like in the real life, right? Like stock, NFT, all the stuff, the values are changing seconds by seconds. So this game does give us like an idea when you are doing a trading NFT, what will happen behind. Because when we are buying or selling NFT, most people are focusing on the money they earn, right? Just like if I got some NFTs and what I'm focusing on, whether will the value of those NFT like goes up, increase so I can earn more money as I could. But then I didn't really focus on like those negative impact that we found during research. Like just now, my teammates said that about the environment. When we are trading NFT, we actually consume a lot of energy, right? And this is, NFT buyers won't think of this. But after this, me, my friends, and my playtesters, we all started to realize that it actually creates more negative impact than we thought. Yeah, so it changes my behavior or my thoughts on whether it affect my decisions on buying NFT. So I think it actually brings some like changes on my real life.
So it seems like it actually worked.
Yeah.
So which is one of the reasons why in the final game design project, we asked students to really try and use games for a real world problem, because games are such a powerful tool and they're often underutilized in that respect. So I think you were the kind of one of the project managers, right? And so, I mean, gaming is always supposed to be fun and so on, but organizing game design team can also be challenging. Can you tell a bit more, like, were there some specific challenges you had in the game design process and did you overcome them maybe through playing or I don't know, what did you observe?
So one of like the biggest challenge we have is that we're like a group of six. So it's extremely hard to like schedule a meeting where everybody is like present, because like we barely have like any days where we're like off free. So it's like extremely hard to schedule and like keep everyone up to date. So like one of the biggest challenging is like being like open to communication and like saying like exactly like what you need and like just basically like writing down notes in like your meetings and like and telling them to like the people who weren't present, yeah, as well as like what you need from them.
Yeah. Do you have any words of wisdom for future game design students or game designers?
Write down like every change or like decision you make in the meeting, like where everybody can see and like look at it, like in case they forget or like they're not there. And then have like a centralized like folder or like a Figma file to like store all your assets. So people could like see all the changes made, like that, like you actually made, and yeah.
Yeah. So last question, like if you had some more time to further improve the game, it seems like it went already through a lot of iterations. What would you focus on?
I think the thing right now we were kind of talking about is our rule sheet. Actually, that was the one thing we found some problems consistently in the playtest, where it's it was a little bit confusing, a little bit daunting. So it's either I think we rewrite that and just make it a bit more solid. And in terms of like actual game stuff, I think we're in a pretty good place. We're very happy with how it looks right now. But if we wanted to maybe, you know, make specific chain counters and just so the visuals reflect the message even more, I think that'd be something that'd be cool to explore. Yeah.
I think I do have one more question for you. So we use tabletop simulator. So instead of using like physical board games and going to the dollar store or whatever to get the materials, was it actually useful, or do you think this was more like making it more complicated?
I'm going to speak for myself here, unless you guys have objections. But
you want me to take that, because I was the one who did the tabletop.
Okay, yeah.
I would say it created some more challenges, but also made things pretty simple. Like for example, adding the event cards at the start, I didn't realize that you could just put it into a sheet and just have it cut up for you. So when I learned that, all of a sudden making changes to all the event cards got a lot easier, and I was like, okay, let's just make all these massive changes, like very nice and easy, right? And it was something I could do pretty quickly whenever we had a play test, right? If I noticed a card was wrong, or you know, it was using past an outdated version, it was very easy to just put it on a sheet and then import it into the game and then continue playing, like probably like a 5-minute delay. Yeah. So it was pretty nice.
Any objections? All right, so the other advantage is that you, the audience, everybody would get a chance to actually play these games. So in a week or so, they should all be finalized and updated and put online, and we'll add this to our course website. So wherever you are, you should be able to play it if you have a tabletop simulator license, and contact the teams. So all the team websites are on the course website. So let's thank this team and all the other teams again. Thanks. And they taped it so nicely here that I still managed to run over the cable. All right, so this concludes our online portion of this session. So thanks again for joining from wherever you joined. And this will be recorded. We'll put this on the website. Thanks again for everybody for playing in here. This was kind of the first attempt basically to do kind of a hybrid in-person plus online. In a way, ironically, it's a lot easier to do a whole showcase online because everything's online. Now we have basically 1, 2, 3, 4 screens, 6 different screens here set up basically to try and work it. So hopefully one of the recordings worked. Thanks again for all the cool projects. And so we'll end our live stream here. Thanks to everybody who joined remotely, and we'll bring it back to this person. So yeah, you can just close the Zoom.